Hi everyone, and welcome to another episode of Small Talk. I'm Amy, this is my partner Maggie.
Hello.
Together we are ThinkerThemer, and we're here in 2022.
Yes, new year.
Yeah.
We made it.
Happy new year to
everybody. Yes.
Hope you've had a very safe and relaxing holiday season. Mm. We, as you can see, are not at home.
Nope.
We are at my mum's house in Queensland, so we're still interstate and enjoying a bit of a break.
Mm-hmm.
We've been playing lots of games.
We have, yes.
Yep.
Trying to force the family to play games even when they're not super keen to.
Look, to be fair, they've been pretty receptive.
Yeah, they've been very, very good.
We've had some game nights.
Yes.
My mum has invited her neighbours over, and we've been playing some party games together. There were lots of laughs over New Year's Eve. Some what do we play on New Year's Eve?
We played Just One.
Always a hit.
The Guretama trick-taking game.
Mm-hmm.
We played Inkling. Yeah, which is also a great hit.
That's been a big hit.
Yes.
Immediately people wanted to buy it, which is amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
We've had a lot of fun.
Mm.
We played some Dream Crush as well. That was a big hit for us this year.
Yeah, that's always a great hit.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we had a wonderful Christmas. We didn't go overboard buying each other presents this year because really we buy ourselves presents all year with the games.
Yeah, so we had a very tough only one game for each other.
We did,
yes. Which we both kind of broke in a sort of
kind
way.
Of, because then we were like, we also buy an extra one for the family.
Yeah, and I was like, well, I bought an extra one, but I left it at home. So technically it wasn't a Christmas present. And it's probably going to be more like first week of Jan. So that's more like the three wise men in South America. We have presents both at Christmas Day and then like lesser presents or like a smaller lot of usually just school supplies because we tend to go back to school in January around like the first week around the 7th, I think 6th or 7th. So that's the three wise men second present.
And waiting for them to come and bring me more gifts.
Yeah, and it's not gold.
It's not gold.
Probably closer to myrrh and frankincense. I don't even know what myrrh is.
But the two games that we did give each other on Christmas Day, Maggie gave me Aquasphere by Stefan Feld, which I'm really excited to play. And we have been recommended a few times on the channel, or me specifically.
Yeah.
And Maggie got Imperial Settlers,
Empires of the North, which I've been waiting for quite a while because I actually really enjoyed Imperial Settlers back in the day when we first kind of got into gaming. I just love the artwork and like the little, you know, little apples and the little, you know, everything about it. And I hadn't gotten a chance to play Empires of the North, and I hear it's a great solo, so I'm excited for that.
Well, and I will leave you to that.
Yeah, because she's not
to play solos.
Yeah, Imperials, Settlers. Yeah, you know,
I haven't played that
Settlers
in a long
fan.
Time. I think it's warranted that we try it again for me.
Yeah.
But yeah, this one was specifically for Maggie to play solo.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'll have to find something else to do as usual. But what else have we been up to? We received a Christmas card.
Yes, we did have one Christmas card.
The coolest Christmas card with a meeple on it.
Yeah, look,
meeple
tree.
Yeah. Do you want to read that?
Yeah, so this is coming from practically neighbors, really. Rick and Laura, dear Amy and Maggie, Merry Christmas from just up the road. I had some extra cards made for the BGG Christmas card exchange and figure it was almost like a postcard. It really is. It's kind of like postcard size. Wishing you yours a festive and playful holiday season. So love it.
Thank you
so much. Yeah, Rick and Laura, you are very nearby. We should play some games.
Meet up and play some games.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So thank you for that card.
Warning, we are on the hunt for friends that have game libraries.
Anyone that has any other games one that we don't have, which means that then great because we get to learn them, but also who can teach us a game because we always have to learn the games and force our friends and family to play them.
I mean, the issue is thank you so much for thinking of us and sending us that. It was such a lovely surprise.
It was really nice.
We love our postcards. We're like,
and
Christmas
we've been holding on to it for so long because we didn't have
a small talk.
We haven't had an episode since
lots has been happening. Yes. We had our booster shots on Boxing Day, which really took me out, which meant that we couldn't record last week, so apologies for not getting our usual Monday video out, which was a real shame, but you know, great to be able to get those booster shots done and out of the way
exactly.
You know, be a bit safer. And what else have we been doing? Well, speaking of friends with board game libraries and whatnot. We have been trying to, because we're in a different state, we have been trying to connect with some people who actually live here, people that we've met through the channel.
Yeah.
And so we've spent a bit of time playing some games. We met some of the Joey fam, which was exciting.
Yes, that was so cool.
We met Kritika and Erin, who we met up with at a game store, Vault Games in Brisbane, if you're a local.
Such a cool setup that they've got there. And they've even got a painting station for a miniature with paint there. And I think it's apparently free. Like their whole setup is you just buy something to drink or a snack, and then you can just sit there and play all day if you want. That was such a great fit out.
It was great. Yeah, and we had a game, and we went out for yumcha for lunch.
We did,
it was very, very cool.
Yeah, it was
and
great.
Then the next day we actually met up with the board game barbecue crew.
Or
rather the team that are here in Brisbane.
Yes.
And we went to Steve's house, and we played a lot of different games, which was amazing.
Yeah.
I was teaching Boon Lake, so we were playing that. We had also taught Merchants of the Dark Road during the week, and we got to play Smartphone Inc. And you were playing Escape Plan by Lacerda. You tried the Crew Mission Deep Sea, which I had played actually on BGA, but you hadn't had a chance to play, so you
and
got
it,
to try
it
that.
It plays fairly, like I feel like obviously it's still the same kind of trick-taking thing with the missions. I really enjoy it, and it felt fairly similar to the regular, the Crew. But I think I like it more.
I think the challenges are more interesting.
Yeah, so I don't know if it's... Yeah, I just felt I like them equally. I like them both the same. I feel if anything, it's just like more challenges for me. So yeah, that's good.
Yeah, it's good. And it's a co-op game that we actually enjoy. So
yeah,
there's that.
Exactly. Yeah.
But that was a fantastic day as well. Mm. And then we actually got to meet for a coffee Angela or Board Game Gran, who is another content creator who lives here in Queensland as well. And
so
that
lovely.
Was really special. Mm. It's so nice to meet people after talking to people for so long.
Yeah.
Because this has been, you know, we've been in lockdown most of the time and just being able to, you know, form those bonds.
Yeah.
It's been really special.
Yeah.
So lovely to get out and about a bit more and to meet people in real life.
Yeah.
And we're hoping, we'll see what happens, but hoping to get out to, you know, other places in the world eventually this year.
Yes. If we can manage to get things a bit more under control globally.
Anyway,
fingers crossed. Yeah.
Anyway, we also launched a few videos that I just wanted to touch on.
Oh, yes.
Because the end of the year, we pumped out a few videos because we knew we were going away. And so we thought, let's try and create some content in the last couple of weeks. So we really did
a
marathon.
It's like a plant that's going to seed. And it's like, just here, have all of this before it just like
before we
blacks
go.
Out for a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah. So
that was the plan.
A few things happened. We launched our merch. And so many of you have purchased a t-shirt or a
thank
mug
you so much.
Or a hoodie, and it means the world to us. Thank you so much. And that money is going to be put to extremely good use because we are setting up a new, well, not new, but I guess we are redoing our filming space to be able to upgrade some of our equipment to enable us to do more interesting videos and things.
Yeah.
And also we're trying to get some shelving, calyxes on the cards so that we can finally show off our collection because at the moment we just have games everywhere.
Yes.
So thank you so much. The money that has come from the merch will directly support the channel
absolutely.
In 2022.
Yeah.
And of course we'll link below if you want to go and check that out.
Get yourself one of these.
Apparently, if we get to 10,000 subscribers, I think we're at about 9,200 now, we can integrate the merch more into the channel.
Oh, yeah.
So one thing you could also do
like
to help...
Like on YouTube.
Yeah, on YouTube.
Yeah, that's cool.
One thing you could also do to help, if you're not subscribed, please subscribe to the channel. It doesn't cost anything, but it really does help us out. So thank you so much for subscribing
to the joining the channel.
The joining the channel.
That is the membership
which
thing.
Also really helps us out.
Yes.
And that again helps support our channel in 2022. But enough about that. We also did a video about our top 10 two-player games, which was quite funny because we did our top five. We each had our top five. And I think what that meant is that the other five that would make it into our top 10 were, of course, not mentioned. We had our honourable number six.
Yeah.
But the most common question we got in the comments was, what about Targi?
What about Targi?
Have you tried Targi? Maybe you should buy Targi. Where's Targi?
We have played it. We have tried it. We even covered it in a small talk. I believe.
We did.
Yeah. And it's a, you know, it's a good game.
It is a very good game. Yeah. Objectively, it's a very good game.
Yeah.
It wasn't for us.
No.
Yeah.
It just didn't grab us. No. I don't know why. I really enjoy like the artwork on the cards. I quite like the mechanics.
Yeah. I think though, and maybe this is what you would have picked up from our top five, because we're so into heavier Euros, if we ever have time to play a thinkier, heavier game, we tend to be drawn to pulling out one of our big box games, even when it's just the two of us.
Yeah.
So the thing that I value in a two-player game is really like this, the its ease of getting it to the table and the speed of playing. And Targi was a little bit heavier, like a little bit heavier.
That's that's interesting because that's not it for me. I think for me, it's more just the type of puzzle that it is.
Mm.
It's not something that I tend to personally resonate with as much. Like that puzzle, kind of like with Meadow as well, where there's the grid type thing. I'm like, it's just, and again, it's nothing to say that the game is not great because like both those games are fantastic.
Yeah.
But I just don't get excited by the grid puzzle.
Stick. Yeah. So anyway,
so with Imhotep, it's another like Imhotep Duel, another two player. You've got the grid thing, and it's like it's a cool game, but the grid puzzle. Maybe because it's so abstract. I'm going to play the abstract card.
How like convenient.
Potentially.
I like when you can find theme when you want to find theme.
Let's explore. Where have I found theme?
Like Fox and the Forest is in your top five. And you're like...
I did feel
like, ooh,
I
so
did
foxy.
Feel like a sly fox though when on. I did. I was like, well, I think I know what Amy's gonna do. I'm gonna go this way.
If you like the game, you're more inclined to like try and piece it together.
Possibly.
Yeah. Anyway,
I'll give you that.
Anyway, and we also launched a video about our number one game of time. And what I thought was fascinating about that is it was probably about 50-50.
Mm.
Half the people said, I never saw that coming. That was a complete surprise to me that was your number one. And the other half were like, of course.
Yeah. Well,
and I don't think that's got anything to do with the length of time watching the channel. So there were people who have watched the channel pretty much since we started who were still equally surprised at our choice. And I think that we have purposely not spoken about it. I think we always knew it was our number one game. Like we have loved.
Yeah. Yeah.
We have loved this game for a long time.
Yeah.
I don't know whether to talk about the game in case someone hasn't watched it yet.
Oh yeah. Let's not. Just in case.
We won't spoil it.
Just go check out that video.
Go check out that video and come back. But if you have watched it, that game was always going to be our number one game. Mm. And so I think that we just haven't spoken about it on the channel because we thought it would be so obvious that that is our number one game if we spoke about it. Because if you watch the video, you will see how passionate we are.
I mean, I've spoken about it in other lists that I've been a part of. And that's all I'll say. I mean, probably everyone watching this has already seen it. It's like, we know what the game is. But yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, so that was another one of our videos. Mm-hmm. And it's just interesting sometimes to see the response to these videos that are outside of our regular routine. So we have been doing for a year now the small talk and back chat and alternating weeks.
Yep.
And the amazing thing is we have such an incredible community who has really rallied behind those two series.
Yeah, it's so great.
It's so great. Yeah. And especially this series, Small Talk, we just had no idea that anyone would really want to listen to us talk for this long.
Yeah.
And it's been so nice to communicate in the comments and things. But then there's also this like feeding the YouTube algorithm.
So it's like what YouTube thinks it's not just what YouTube thinks, but what then gets distributed more, what gets clicked on more. And
what
then
people are searching for. So if people are searching on YouTube, they're not looking for small talk or back chat. They're looking for the top 10 games.
It's kind of like you come here for, like what brings you here is a random review somewhere potentially, and then you stay for the back chat and the small talk.
Well, we hope.
Yeah. Well, this is like, this makes sense once you kind of have the relationship and we, you know, then we can just kind of chill and chat and talk games and life.
Probably when you first come across one,
it's like,
what is
not at
this?
All invested
they're
in not, this.
When are they going to get to the games that are here?
In which case, if that's you, just skip to the timestamp.
That's why there's timestamps. Yeah. But we do usually in this series talk through some IAQs or some infrequently asked questions.
Yeah. Never gets old for me. I don't know why. It always gets me. Yeah.
And so if you do have a question for us, please feel free to drop it in the comments below, and we will attempt to answer it. If not in the next episode, then certainly when we get to it. If you've asked a question and we haven't covered it, drop it in the comments.
Ask it again.
This often happens. Yeah, we are very behind in our responses to comments at the moment. I apologize. We have been trying to spend some time with family and, you know, actually get to the table and play a lot of our backlog of games.
Yeah.
So we've been a little less online than usual.
Yeah.
But we will get back to it.
Get to the questions.
Oh, sorry. Okay. okay. Having played our number one game. This is a question from Mer. So coming... okay, this is a bit hard because it talks about our number one game.
Okay.
But our number one game has a solo that has no AI.
Yes.
And Mer asks, what other games have low upkeep or no AI or no facilitation that you could recommend?
Well, that's my favorite, is games where you can just play pretty much exactly the same game and you don't have to like split your mind into, well, now I have to facilitate the AI and they have this complicated flowchart of things that they do, or, you know. So I love, other games that I love, Newsfeared is another game where you don't really, there's no AI, you're just actually playing as two separate colors and kind of blocking yourself in subsequent rounds.
Newsfeared is also a great game for two players.
It does play great, yeah, it's a great two player.
Yeah, we've done a full review of it, but at two players, it feels you get that big box Euro experience, but in a two player.
And it plays super quick as well, so it's a great one. And what else? Pretty much every game that I love playing solo will usually be that setup. Off the top of my head, I'm trying to think. I love the Bloody Inn solo, and again, that's one of those like, oh, you're not really facilitating an AI. All you're doing is you're doing more. I believe it's more just kind of putting additional visitors in the different rooms. So it's very low maintenance. Maglev Metro, which we played recently, has another great, it's just essentially a timer where you're just taking out little pieces out of the bag, and so it's just running out your time. There's another very easy solo. What else?
Hadrian's Wall.
All you really have is you've got the card and it gives you someone to trade with, but they're not really doing anything. So that's another great one. What else? Viticulture, actually, which is interesting because it's like the first automa or the first AI, and yet it's actually quite simple. It's just like blocking one action and that's it. I feel like every other automa that came after that was so much more complicated. So, but yeah, that one was, quite nice. So there's several that are just Winter Queen, which we covered recently as well. Very, very simple implementation as well.
Yeah, I would check out Maggie's top 10 solo games that she did with Rado on Rado's channel. I'll link to that below because Maggie has a strong preference to not have an automa or an AI involved in
Mage
the
Knight,
solo.
I just thought of another Mage Knight. Again, it's just like one card that it's a timer thing, but the rest of the game is just, you're free to do whatever you like.
And before anyone asks, no, we haven't got that back to the table as a two-player game, but we will. We will one day.
Yeah.
Whew, there's such a long list. But thank you so much for
that question. Yeah, thank you for that question. It's a great question.
Sis asks, and we have answered a similar question to this before, but what's our favorite video games? So we'll touch on that briefly.
Just in general.
Just in general, our favorite video games. Maggie's, I think we've talked about at length on this channel.
Well, Stardew Valley is one of them.
Stardew Valley. Hundreds of hours on Stardew Valley.
But the ones that I always get really excited about is actually Grand Theft Auto. Whenever there's a new Grand Theft Auto that drops.
Which is completely bizarre because it's extremely violent.
Well, and I was thinking about this. It's like, but I don't do gratuitous violence for the sake of gratuitous violence. Like, I'm actually more into like the exploring the broadness of that world and going through all the different missions. And yes, the violence is kind of unavoidable. Mm. But I'm more about those things, just exploring the story, unfolding the story as much as possible. Yeah.
And we play a lot of Oculus. We both have Oculus Quest. Yeah. And we love music rhythm games.
Yeah, I love
mainly.
Synth Rider.
Synth Rider is my favorite. Beat Saber is your favorite.
Beat Saber is my
favorite. Maggie's very good at Beat Saber.
Not that great. I felt like I was really good at the start, and then I kind of stopped playing, and now everyone has well surpassed me to the point where, like, when I try and play multiplayer, like, online, it's like, nah, I can't even keep up.
And I actually, like, this year I would like to play more video games. I have a friend.
Is this a resolution?
A friend that lives nearby actually has a PlayStation 5, and I have bought another controller so that I can go and hang with him, and we can play some split screen co-op games. So I'm excited about that. I actually do enjoy co-op games when they are electronic digital games.
Bizarre.
Strange.
Yeah.
But thank you for that question, Sis.
Yeah.
String 808, what is our love language? Now, this is interesting because we've always spoken about our love language, not on the channel, just together. Yeah. And the concept of love language is how do you express your love to your partner, and how do you want to receive love from your partner? But we'd never actually read the original text. Mm-hmm. So my mum has had that book sitting on her shelf since probably, I don't even know when it came out, the 80s maybe?
No, 90s, I think.
90s? Yeah. And so I always remember that book being there, but neither of us had actually read the original text.
Yeah. So you always hear of, like, the five love languages and this sort of as a concept. I agree.
Yeah.
And I didn't actually know much about it. I just sort of went like, oh yeah, kind of makes sense that people would code things differently as, oh, this means that, you know, you care about me or you love me kind of thing. But so I ended up doing there's like a little quiz to give you the breakdown of the percentages. I also went down the path of, like, actually downloading the book and starting to read it without realizing that it's
quite outdated.
Well, it's a very religious Christian and not that that in itself is an issue, because that's not, but the book itself, everything is very heteronormative. It's assuming that it's essentially just like marriage or about marriage, and that it's a straight couple, and that, so there's some
very
concepts
like
quite
stereotypical gender roles and that type of thing, which is kind of like
so it's like that out, like, outside of that, the concept itself of the different ways of communicating love, like, makes sense, but it's sort of like a
and it helps you
warning if you're gonna go into the book, that it's sort of from that angle,
a very outdated perspective.
I'm just gonna say
the five love languages are really interesting because it's a way of kind of understanding your partner and what your partner needs from you. So I enjoyed this question, what is our love language? And it generated a lot of conversation between us. Of course, I gave Maggie the heads up about this question so we could, like, discuss it. Yeah. And I think what's interesting is, like, our differences a little bit. So for me, the way that I need love is really about gifts of service, which is kind of, like, that is true of our relationship, I think.
So it'd be like, if I make her a cup of tea,
bring me the coffee in the morning.
Bring you the coffee or do something nice. Do you, like, fold laundry or do, like, take the dog for a walk or, like, make your life easier in some way.
And when I was doing the quiz, a lot of those questions were about, you know, as someone who is quite, you know, I've been quite type A list making, very, like, like a planner, especially pre-COVID, and kind of like always a lot on my mind. So I always know that I've got these 10 things to do. And so if you can take one of those 10 things away from me and reduce my stress, that is really meaningful to me. So that made a lot of sense to me why that is so important. Also, I am really messy.
So I can be cleaning up behind her.
I'm horrendously messy. Not dirty, but just I leave a trail of destruction behind me. I get halfway through things and then I get distracted. And my one chore that I hate is the laundry. I cannot tell you how much I hate laundry because it never ends. And sorry, because it never ends, but because there's always a next step in the process. It's like, oh, you put it in the washing machine, but then you've got to remember to take it out and then hang it out, and then you've got to like, or put it in the dryer.
And then as soon as you're finished, it's like the clothes that you're wearing are going to be dirty. And then, so it's like, yeah, it just, it never ends.
So I'm really appreciative that Maggie does, well, most of our laundry.
My number one, which again, is like my number one language, but it's still only like 33%, was quality time, which is your number two.
Very close to 30%.
Which is about just like being able to like spend time together, which then ends up meaning like we spend a lot of time together.
We spend a lot of time together. I would say more than most couples, probably.
More than most people on the face of the earth.
Yeah. We do. Yeah. And especially in the last 2 years, of course, because we were stuck together.
Stuck together. In that. But it's like, that was fine then. Because it's like we,
But I think you can probably tell if you've been watching this channel for a while that we have a similar sense of humor and we're always laughing together. I think
we are.
Yeah, we do spend a lot of time together, but we don't tire of each other's company.
No.
And because we have so many shared interests, especially board games, but like we really like gaming and we like going out and having nice food and there's like, you know, lots of things that we enjoy together. So
it's interesting though that like we code quality time differently, and I didn't realize this till recently. We were talking about this, where for me as a solo, like multiplayer solitaire, for me quality time is like whenever we're around each other and we're just like hanging out, like that to me is quality time. But to Amy, because she needs that interaction, it's like if we're just hanging out but we're each doing our own thing, I will code that in my language as like, hey, we're spending quality time, we're kind of being together.
Not at all.
Whereas for you, not at all. Like unless we're actually engaged doing something together, like we're playing a game, we're like exploring something, we're like going out and doing an activity together, that doesn't actually code as quality time.
And even the activity, so if we're out together doing the grocery shopping, that is not quality time.
Whereas to me, I'm like, hey, quality time, we're spending time together.
Mine is like, okay, we've actually taken a break and now we're going out for dinner, or we're going to sit down and play a board game together. That to me is quality time.
Which is interesting because I'm just realizing oftentimes
yours is like, just time.
Yeah,
it's not even quality.
But that feels like quality to me. I'm like, yeah, this is high quality because it's like. But I like now I'm thinking sometimes we'll go out into a shop and like for example if I might be clothes or even like the groceries and I'll just be like, oh yeah, I'll be doing like whatever, and then you'll be like, can you be present? Can you be here? Can you be? I'm like, what do you mean? Like I'm here.
Yeah, this
like,
is quality time.
But it's just because we code it differently. So.
Yeah. Yeah, that is interesting.
What else?
The low down on both of our lists last was actually gifts.
Yeah, mine was like 3%.
Mine was also 3%.
You don't need to give me stuff.
Yeah, so we need to reevaluate present giving. I think I give you more presents, maybe because you do more chores and I'm like, ooh, better buy my way out of it.
Actually, words of affirmation was my second highest. So all you need to do is whenever, if I do anything nice and you're like, oh, just say, oh, thank you,
oh, babe. Thank you so much for like, doing our washing.
And I'll be like chuffed and be like, yeah, that's all I need. You know? And maybe that's why, like, if I'm losing in a game and you can see that I'm getting like, just be like, hey, but that was a great move. And like, that was a, you know, like, I think that'll be, I'm giving you the keys to like a piece. The Maggie monster when I'm losing by a lot and I start getting grumpy or stroppy.
I was just counting how many we've been through. So words of affirmation.
Yes.
Like being told that
so
you're loved.
Time, words of affirmation.
Was third for me.
Yep.
And then physical touch is the other one, which must be fourth on both of our lists.
No, so it was third on mine.
Oh, third on yours.
Yeah, and
yeah,
fourth,
and fourth on mine.
So it sort of sits in a similar...
Yeah, and that one's an interesting one to me. It's not because I am like, I don't like being
don't
touched.
Recoil.
Yeah, it's like, oh, don't touch me.
Yeah.
It's just that I... Yeah, I think probably I'm a bit more cerebral?
Yeah, cerebral.
With that?
Yeah.
Cerebral with that? Mm. Like, I prefer to be told. Like, it doesn't necessarily have to be signaled to me in physical touch. And also, I think that is a weird kind of result of growing up gay as well. Because
yeah,
you learn not to show physical, well, I did certainly, where I was growing up in more of a country town environment, to not show physical touch in public.
Yeah, the hesitancy, like, is it safe? Are we going to get in? Are we going to attract unwanted attention?
Yeah, because several times I, you know, would hold hands with my partner at the time and attracted a lot of unwanted attention.
Yeah.
And that's changed a lot now, thank goodness, and especially because we live in a much more metro area now.
Yeah.
But it's still been kind of coded in that not to need that as much, I think. Yeah.
And I think the other thing is like, you get hot very easily, and I run, and I get cold very easy, but I run very hot. I'm like, and I probably, that's from why I'm always feeling cold, because my body's constantly just...
Because you're from Venezuela, and I think because you're in a hot environment, like your body is much more efficient at keeping you cool.
Yeah, so if I get, like, if I hug Amy or anything, she'd be like, this is so hot. Like, and I'm like, I can't help it.
Now they're imagining that we need a couch like this in our regular house so that we're like far away from each other. No, we definitely do hug and show affection that way. But it's just not high on what we need.
No. Yeah. No. Lucky.
Lucky. Thank you so much for that question. That was really interesting. Mm. Jason asks, are we more competitive head to head? Versus when we're just with other people.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'd definitely say we are.
Even when we're with other people, we'll be competitive with one another. Yeah. Like, we'll be playing a multiplayer game. And it's like, if there's someone that you can be mean to, we'll usually, like pick one another.
Yeah, see, I think you're more like that in a multiplayer. Like, Maggie will definitely make sure that I'm the one that's not beating her by a lot.
Mm.
But that's not true of me in a multiplayer game, because I'm just very aware of like what I need to do to beat the next person.
Right,
closest
so you're there
to
for
me.
Like optimization.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Like, if I need to be mean, I don't want to be mean to anybody else. I'll be mean.
Sometimes
to
I'll be mean to you just because socially it's more acceptable to be mean to your partner than someone else.
Yeah.
But if we're playing just the two of us, it's on. Like, we're pretty competitive with each other. So thank you.
Yeah, that's a good question as well.
Good question, Jason. Mm. And Emma asks, how do you explain to people about our hobby? Often, you know, Emma gets a puzzled look and then, oh, so you like Monopoly? And how do you not be rude about that? And that is a really interesting question. And it's happened to us quite a few times because my mum has had neighbours over who have been quite intrigued by the amount of games that we packed into our suitcase because...
The embarrassing number of games.
Behind the camera, there's a huge pile of games. We actually upgraded our suitcases so that we could get the biggest possible suitcase that could be checked.
That is legally allowed on a plane.
And then we packed those two suitcases full of games and put all of our clothes and gifts and everything else into our hand luggage.
Yeah.
So it was playing Tetris in the suitcases.
Literally the only clothes that we packed was what was able to fit in between the games to like help protect the games from one another. Essentially clothes were not prioritized at all.
Yeah, and on top of the two suitcases we also had a board game bag.
Yeah, that's right.
That we filled with bubble wrap and we made sure everything was packaged really carefully. And that actually worked really well.
It did actually,
Actually now I'm thinking when we travel we should just bring empty like to a con.
Yeah,
we could bring the empty board game.
Bit.
Yeah, they could collapse down. Anyway.
Yeah. I don't know how well they're fit because obviously this was just one single trip. I think if you had multiple like stopovers and things like that, like I feel like there's more opportunity for luggage to be handled really roughly.
Yeah.
And
but anyway, so we had, what was the question? Oh yeah. About, explaining about the hobby. So the neighbors were coming through the door and seeing this huge pile of games. And when people realize that the hobby is much more than what they remember it being or what it is to them, it always inevitably ends up with this conversation about modern day board gaming, especially when you say, oh, we've got around 300 games. You know, you get that like look of
like, what? Are there 300?
Are there 300 games? Yeah, like, and then you're like, well, yeah.
There's actually 2,000 new ones every year.
Yeah, and then it leads down this like path of, and it is interesting because we try not to like, I played Monopoly growing up. I played a lot of Monopoly growing up. And we played all of these games that really influenced the hobby, but also influenced us as gamers. Mm. And so I think it's important not to be judgmental in that conversation because
don't be nasty.
People don't know what they don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
If you've never been fortunate enough to sit down with someone who can teach you one of these new games, then like pre-Dominion and Ticket to Ride and all the games that we started with, like we had no clue either.
Yeah, exactly. And so I usually talk about it as, oh, no, it's sort of the new, so it's almost like, kind of when they say Monopoly, but this is more what's now known as the new generation of hobby board gaming, which, and so it kind of establishes that, oh, no, this is a, it's in the realm, but it's a new, different, separate thing.
Yeah, and I talk about the evolution as well. Like, you know, those games were really popular, but, you know, they've also evolved and people have taken key ideas out of them and it's changed. And now there's more and more that come out every year.
Yeah.
And yeah, and then, you know, immediately we try and convince them to play a new board game.
And inevitably they'll be like, so what's your favorite board game? And it's like, I'm about to tell you something that will make no sense and mean yeah. nothing to you. And then you just get that blank look like, yeah, that's exactly what I thought. So I think I need to work on that. I need to work on, finding a better answer.
I think maybe
that.
If we explain it thematically, then that's what gets people. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
What gets people more interested yeah. in the hobby. But
it can sometimes just be like, oh, that sounds like a lot.
It's also hard because you explain that you love board games and then they want to play a board game with you, but you have to start them on the most simple kind of board games.
Yeah,
and in the environment that we were in, that meant like a party board game, which is not the best representation of the games that we really love, like the dry Euros of the world. And so it's like you're kind of introducing them to the new hobby, but it's not really
but at a real compromise sort of level.
Yeah. Anyway,
that's interesting, actually. I hadn't actually stopped to think about that. Maybe we need to find a more... But that's the other thing. Often it happens, people associate board games with a big group of people. It's like, oh, you mean like Pictionary? You mean like... Because that's what, like, historically, Games Night was. And so I think often when you want to introduce them, even if it was to like an intro, gateway, more Euro-y type thing, you rarely... Like, they play usually better at four... And often there's more than that when you have the game snacks.
I think over time you can level people up as well. So it's like, oh, I love Pictionary. It's like, oh, well, have you tried Telestrations?
Yeah.
And then they get excited about that. And then you're like, oh, let's try something different. And then before you know it, they have 300 board games in their collection.
Yeah. And that would be another interesting one to explore. What seems to be the common trajectory of someone that catches the board gaming bug? Because there's definitely like steps. Yeah. I feel like there's going to be a Paula Deming like sketch in that.
there probably is already
of all the different stages of board game hobby addiction.
Yes. Anyway, that is everything that we have for our IAQs. Mm. If you have a question for us, please drop it in the comments below. But for now, we should probably talk about some board games. We have been playing a lot. Since we've had time off work and with the family, and it never feels like enough because we've made a very small dint in the amount of games that we brought here, but much more than we usually play. So that's been exciting.
Let's
talk some games. So why don't we start with Three Sisters?
Ooh.
So Three Sisters is I feel like this is very precarious.
Oh,
at some stage,
it's very exciting because this could collapse at any point.
At any moment.
Yeah.
If I lean back in this lazy boy chair, things will go flying.
Yeah.
Anyway, don't do that. Three Sisters is a roll and write game.
Mm.
And it is by the same designers as Fleet the Dice Game, which was a game that was hugely popular last year. And this actually feels quite similar, but it introduces a rondel. And that does add another layer to the game. Hmm. So what happens in this game is you are going to be trying to build out your garden. And Three Sisters is actually refers to a technique that was common with...
the Native American...
Native American people where...
Like agriculturally.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of like, what are the three actual...
So I believe it's beans, corn, and squash or pumpkin. Yeah.
And when you plant them together, they actually work harmoniously together to grow a more productive crop.
Mm.
And so that is the concept that the game is based on.
Piggyback on one another.
Yeah, that's right. That's the concept that the game is based on. And so in your little sheet, you've actually got two sheets that you're working on.
Mm-hmm.
One is the main one, which is your garden. And your garden is made up of lots of different sections. And you're going to be able to plant things in this garden and also water them. Mm. And this is a game that is heavily based on combos. So you're going to be trying to elongate your turn as much as possible by collecting crates, I want to say.
that's the project, or the goods.
The goods.
Yeah,
the goods that are depicted by a little crate.
Market.
Yeah, but you can also grow fruits and you can grow perennials, so flowers, and all of these things are going to interact together to give you more and more turns. And if you do it efficiently, just like in Hadrian's Wall or in Fleet the Dice game, you're going to be able to take more turns.
Yeah.
There's also the Shed, which has all of these one-off abilities or ongoing abilities or victory points that are going to allow you to get more done in the game or break the game in certain ways. And the rondel itself is really interesting because that's the action selection system. So on your turn, you're going to be rolling all of the dice, mm-hmm. and then you're going to be putting them out around this rondel, and then everyone in turn order is going to choose a die from the rondel. That's not only going to dictate the number is going to dictate something in the game or like about the garden.
Which garden you use.
Yeah, which one you can grow in or water. Mm-hmm. And then you also get to do the action based on the rondel where you took that die.
Yeah.
And so the game goes on and on like that. It is, I really, really enjoyed it. You know who enjoyed it? My mum really enjoyed it. She's an avid gardener and it's quite heavy for her.
It's very heady and very thinky.
It is.
There's a lot of different things where you're like, oh, what about, the sort of interconnection of things. Yeah.
The rondel does make it more complex, I think, than Fleet the Dice game. Mm. So, but what it shares in common is the die that's left over. In this case, the die that's the lowest value that's remaining gets mm-hmm. used by everyone around the table as well. So it still gives you that little question mark about what else am I going to get to do at the end of the turn? And it's just about being efficient.
Yeah. To me, it feels like a more cerebral or heavier roll and write. So for a combo-tastic type game, I felt like, I wouldn't say that it's particularly newbie friendly. Like if I were to introduce somebody to a roll and write, I would not start with this because this is going to be a bit more for...
There's a lot of steps.
There are a lot of steps and there's a lot of, what does this do again? Or how does this work with that again? And how does this... So yeah, I would probably bring in a medium player to this. Mm-hmm. I personally found that what I was excited about this game was like, a theme that I like. I like farming and I like kind of growing things. But it didn't actually, from a thematic point, I think I like the theme, but it didn't flow thematically for me. Yes, technically there's the whole thing of you have to grow, the corn to a certain level before you can add the bean. But to me, it felt like that was the extent of the thematic sort of things that made sense from a thematic point of view.
Mm.
Everything else just was kind of like, oh, yeah, so this is over here and that's over here and this kind of triggers a combo, but there was no real thread thematically through those. And I actually felt very similar to this to Fleet the Dice game, where it's like, it's interesting, but it's not probably the one that I would choose
myself. So interesting to me because I really enjoy Fleet the Dice game and I really enjoyed Three Sisters. And for me, it has a similar feel to Hadrian's Wall, which is a game. Which is a game that Maggie likes. So I'm very surprised that you don't like the other two that I would say are very combo based and heavier roll and write. So that is quite interesting. I really enjoyed this one.
Yeah, I don't know why, because it's like I love Hadrian's Wall, and it is very on the surface it seems like it should be very similar, but I don't know why. There's something else in the, I think it's the flow.
Yeah.
I feel like with this and with Fleet, like I felt like I would stumble going, oh wait, what does this do again with that and that, and so it didn't feel like, that's what I mean, it hits more at a heady level than like a intuitive flow. Yeah, this makes sense that it would go here or this. Yeah,
and that's one thing about it is that there are more steps, which makes it less beginner friendly, which means when do we get this out to play? And if we were to get out a roll and write just to play you and I, then we'd probably get out like Hadrian's Wall. So because it's even more heavy.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. I would still keep it in my collection. I think it's a great game and I'm excited to see what these designers do next.
I should talk about the solo as well. So it does have a solo mode. I was very surprised with this one because the solo mode plays very, like it actually feels like a completely different game to the main game, because what happens is you have I can't remember now the name of the farmer that is the AI, but what that farmer is doing is they're crossing out things or eliminating options for you to take in subsequent turns. So even though it's, I would say it's mild to moderate overhead in terms of the things that you have to do, it's not super complicated once you kind of get the flow of it. I didn't feel like I got to really play out the core puzzle, because it's very different. It's like it's just eliminating options for you, which would never happen in the multiplayer game. So that was an interesting implementation. But again, like if you enjoy this sort of if you enjoy the main one and you don't have anyone else to play with, it might be worth giving it a go.
Cool. character is three sisters.
Three sisters.
What do you want to talk about next?
Let's talk about Momiji.
Momiji is, we have the deluxe Kickstarter edition. So Three Sisters, I should also say, was a Kickstarter back.
Yes.
Momiji was one of our other many Kickstarter backs, and it came in recently.
Mm-hmm.
And Momiji is thematically about the change of the season in Japan in fall, where
the colors of the
beautiful
leaves
all change color. We are fortunate to have actually taken my mum over to Japan and experienced this beautiful season where a lot of the temples and shrines, they actually have viewing kind of special viewing times to go and look at, like, what is, it looks like a painting. Like,
yeah,
just
it is
beautiful.
Just visually stunning.
So stunning. And when you have, like, the temples and then all of the beautiful red and oranges, it's just amazing. That is what this game is based on.
Mm-hmm.
However, the game itself is a quite abstract game based on suits of cards.
Mm-hmm.
So in this game, depending on how many players you have, you're going to be introducing different suits. And the way that it's played is primarily through drafting, a central draft of cards. There are going to be cards that are revealed. If the same type is, if the same suit is revealed, it gets stacked on top of the same suit.
Mm.
And you're simply going to be choosing what you want to pick from that draft or what you want to take from that center selection of cards.
Yeah.
Market, thank you. Mm. Market of cards. Or you're going to be playing down in front of you. When you play down in front of you, you're going to be making a stack of like suited cards that range from 0 to 3.
Yeah.
And you have to put them in order.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to start with 0 and then you'll add 1s, 2s, and 3s. As soon as you add a 3, that stack is done with. You put a little Tori symbol token on top of it.
Yeah.
And at the end of the game, you're going to be multiplying out each of your piles. So you can only have one pile of each suit. You're going to be multiplying out the number of cards in that pile times the top value of the card. So obviously you want to try and get a 3 to be the last card and close off that pile so that the number of cards is multiplied by the 3 to have the most powerful.
Which reminds me of Trek 12, which we did recently, where it's like the sequence, the way you score is like the sequence, the number of items in the sequence times the highest number that you manage to get in that sequence, which is a, I find that an interesting mechanic. With this one, I think overall the artwork is beautiful. The components are really cute, like all the little acorns and like the cards, the illustrations on the cards, it's really beautiful. It is a, there's a couple of other bonus modules as well that you can add, but the core, the core game itself is fairly straightforward in the sense that it's straightforward, but it doesn't make, it doesn't mean that it's simple or easy.
No, I think some of the decision-making space is quite interesting in this game because there's also the opportunity to buy an end-game scoring condition where you're kind of gambling that you're the one that's going to have the most of any one suit or the most acorns left over, which are the currency in the game.
Yeah.
There's also, so, you know, you're scoring the cards, but there's also these three actions that you get to activate once each during the game by paying acorns.
Mm-hmm.
And the acorns are the currency, but they're also worth VP at the end of the game. So there are a couple of interesting decisions here. One, I think, is the race element in the game. So do I need to close off these stacks?
Yeah.
Because the game ends when all of the Tory gates are kind of spent, which means that you're constantly watching how quickly are other people building out their their suit stacks?
Yeah.
Versus, like, do I race ahead or do I try and put as many cards into each of those stacks as possible to maximize my score at the end, noting that if you keep putting zeros and ones, the multiplication is only going to be 0 or 1, which is not going to give you very much at the end.
Yeah.
So I really like that. I like that you have to spend victory points in order to activate the special abilities because that's another tension in the game.
Yeah.
And I just think the production value of this game is exceptional. It's beautiful.
Yeah, the production is really beautiful.
Mm.
I would say just in general, because the main puzzle of it is really just like a number sequence and a bit of memory because obviously the cards are limited. So you're also kind of counting, oh, have all the threes for this come out? In which case me trying to hold out for that three or that it's just futile. Mm. So
there mention the matching part.
So there's another
like
cute little
game within the game where when you're placing cards down to the stacks, if you can have two acorns adjacent to each other, which are usually on either side of the card, it's going to give you more acorns or more victory points.
Yeah, essentially.
So I think this is a really beautiful gateway level kind of game because it is thinky enough that it's actually interesting. The decision space is interesting.
I was going to say, I would say it's intro, a gateway plus. For someone who likes abstract and likes kind of that number sequencing type thing.
Yeah.
Like, this wouldn't necessarily be a good gateway for me because it's not really thematic. I'd be like, oh yeah, okay. It's like a numbers sort of thing.
My only thing is that it's beautiful. All the components are stunning, but it plays like a card game. So
Absolutely, something
to be aware of, that this box could have probably been half the size, to be honest, for what the gameplay is. Like, essentially it is a card game.
Yeah.
But I really do appreciate all the beautiful components that come with it, which gives it more substance, especially those landscape cards. They're really beautiful.
Which
but really
gives
they're
it
just...
a lot of replayability as well, because all those landscape tiles, they have like a one-off ability. There's a lot of variety in those. So again, it would keep the game sort of feeling a little bit fresh, although that's such a small component, but still it gives you a little bit of variability.
Yeah.
It does have a solo mode, so I'll talk about the solo mode as well. So with the solo mode, it's really interesting because it's only really scenarios. So you've got these very specific scenarios that you play. It starts from medium, so there's no easy scenario. You either go medium, and the medium, I still haven't been able to beat it. It's actually really tough. Medium, difficult, or very difficult. It's like, oh, great. So it gives you very specific objectives that you need to meet, and it tells you, well, these are the tasks that you're going to be playing with, and these are the suits. So that was interesting. If you like that type of puzzle, that would keep you... I think the good thing about it being quite tricky is that it gives you opportunities to try different strategies and go, oh, how would I beat that puzzle? Would I be going hard on this? Would I try and like get a good spread of X or Y? So yeah, I think from a solo point, they would have a fair bit of replayability, probably because of the difficulty. Mm. I don't know how you feel in terms of the replayability of the base game.
I like it. I think for me, I really enjoyed the game for what it is. It delivers, I think. The only thing for me is that, again, it feels like the comparison point is another card game rather than a board game.
Yes.
So I'm thinking about if I want to play a card game, then I would turn to this, but it's a little too big to take to someone's house as a card game. Like, the deluxe edition is beautiful, but it is quite...
Yeah.
Not overproduced, but you know, that's what I knew I was getting in for, because that's why I back things at the highest level, to get these beautiful parts.
I think the only reason it would be this size is because there's one of the modules that you can add is the, I can't remember now what it's called. I think it's like the something garden, the secret garden or the imperial garden or something. And it does have a little board that is exactly this size. Mm. And what that adds is it gives you another option of, as you're playing, you can swap cards with the cards that are shown there, and you can kind of move your very, very cute little component meeple along, which then triggers other things. So it's just a way of leveling up the experience of a fairly straightforward base game.
Yeah. So that is Momiji.
You want me to put it on this side?
No, I think
precarious stuff.
Yep.
All right. Let's talk about, all the components are rolling around. Arkham Horror, the card game. This is a game that I had been wanting and talking about for ages, because it's often hailed as a great solo experience, as a very thematic experience. So for the longest time, I was like, I can't wait. And same with, like, I tried Marvel Champions, which is kind of the other kind of great sort of solo, but I'm not into superheroes. And not like I tolerate, like, Marvel is fine, but I'm not like, oh yes, superheroes. So this was going to be a much better theme, I think, for me. Amy's not into horror. She's also not into narratives or, you know, reading story
or co-op.
So yeah, this was never going to be this was always going to be a solo thing. But I finally got to try it. And so I think I must have watched the how to play multiple how to plays multiple times. Late at night, and every single time I kept falling asleep halfway through. So it's one of those that I learned to play probably 20 times. But in terms of the way that it plays, you're all these different investigators, and obviously there's a million and one different expansions, or like new campaigns and added content, but you are in Arkham, and you are all these different investigators or detectives or investigators, and you're trying to you'll play as one of those. You'll have your own unique deck of, you know, abilities and things that you can do, or allies or things that you can play. And as you're investigating these, what is happening, and you're uncovering, or you're revealing the story, there's a lot of, there's a fair, I wouldn't say a lot to read, but there's, you know, beautiful, well, very well written narrative that kind of sets the tone, and you're, yeah, you're uncovering the story as you go. In terms of the things that you can do, you, each one of those investigators has their own unique sort of asymmetric variety of their strengths. So I believe there's like agility versus physical strength versus, I can't remember what, like willpower. And so they all have different levels of those, and you're going to need all those different abilities for different things that will happen in the game. And you're essentially going to be doing not quite a roll for those things, but a check for those things. And the way you do that is you're going to have a bag, the, I think it's the chaos bag or the doom bag, chaos bag, which I was, that does not come with the bag, which then meant that I sent Amy and Amy's mom on this quest to find me a
obscure bag.
I'm like, you gave me an obscure bag, and you're like, what?
An obscure bag?
Do you mean opaque? I'm like, yeah, an opaque, but also I guess obscure would fit the theme of this game. So that was the joke of they were trying to get me an obscure
bag. And it was a little bit lost in translation, wasn't it?
It was very much.
The word in Spanish is
oscuro, like on a oscura or yeah, which is like just yeah, opaque essentially, or opaca would also be the, yeah, just something that is not see-through. So, because what you're doing is you're putting all these different tokens in it, which are, that's your lucky or unlucky dip, where you're doing, when you're doing a check, you have the ability to, like, well, you have to do that, go into the bag, and it's either going to make the check better or more likely worse. So if, for example, I needed to do a one of the locations to investigate a location and get these like kind of clue tokens, say a location might have a value of 2, and so I need to have a, I think it's in that one, it's the book, but I can't remember what it's called. I think it's the willpower. It's not willpower. I can't remember, but that's a thematic fail there. but I need to do a check for that. And so, you know, I might start with a level of 3. And so it's like, oh, great. So I'm already technically winning. But when I put my hand in the bag, I may draw a -2 or a -4, depending on the difficulty that I've set myself for the game. It's the types of the level of doom that goes into that chaos bag, or the minuses and the kind of nasty things that can happen. And so that's what might mean that I will fail or succeed at those checks and progress the story. I like that it has these two little, it's got these act deck and, what is it, act and agenda. So the act is when I'm able to, as the investigator, move the story along with getting enough clues, that progresses the good side of the story. But the agenda is when I'm not able to move that along, every time another turn goes or a different event, we'll add doom tokens onto that. And that's almost like the agenda of the evil that then progresses the story in a bad way and then makes things sort of bad things happen. So it is very much a narrative sort of exploring thing. I did find that after all my build up and my hype and waiting for it, the bit that I enjoyed the most was the story and the discovery of the story. The bit that I didn't enjoy as much is a lot of those checks just felt like they were getting in the way. And they do say, look, you can make it just much, much easier so that you're just more enjoying the story, which is what I wanted. So I actually just wanted more story, if anything. I wanted more story and less fiddling. Because yeah, I did feel like every time I was having to hug, and now I have to sort this out, and now I have to figure this out. It's like, I just want to know the story. So I enjoyed it, but I feel like I'm more keen now to check out some of the other campaigns to see, yeah, now that I kind of know how the mechanics work, I can just get lost into, well, what are these other stories and what happens in these other scenarios?
Millions of dollars later.
It's not cheap. Yeah, I kept hearing of how expensive it is. And it's like, well, yeah, because every new pack is like another, at least in Australian dollars, like $40, $50 plus. Yeah.
So if you're a fan of Arkham Horror, drop in the comments, like, what should Maggie get next?
Yeah, what is the must campaign that I should check out next?
Yeah. And it was a delight listening to you talk about that, but I know for sure It would not be my thing.
Zero interest in it for you.
No, I was shifting around in my seat a little bit, just thinking about like the fiddliness combined with a narrative campaign.
It's not that fiddly. No, it's not that bad. And I should say, like, essentially what happens is you can, there is a campaign element where when you're going from game to game or from episode to episode, your investigator does the things that they grow, their deck, you know, sort of evolves, and you get these skill points that you can spend on, you know, this better cards. And so you do look forward to, like, oh, now I'm going into the next game with a better deck. No, not yet. I also love the deck building aspect, the deck constructing, because you're not really deck building along the way, but constructing a deck before you start. Like, I was really into that as well.
So maybe let me talk about my abstract game.
All right, I'll stop talking about
it. Stop talking. Let me talk about my abstract game. Let me talk about my completely themeless game.
Yeah.
So another comment that came up in the top two player games of all time was, where is Yinsh? For me, because in my top five, I had the game Devon. Mm-hmm. And Devon is from the same series, the Gip Project, that Yinsh is part of as well, which are all very similar games. And this is one that is probably I think it's the highest rated on BGG out of the series of games. And it is an extremely close second to Devon, but I didn't want to have, I guess I wouldn't put both in my top 10 list, probably. I may or may not. I hadn't really solidified the rest of my top 10. Mm. But Yinsh is an excellent game as well. It is played out on a grid that is very similar to Devon in that it is lines that are kind of creating these triangular shapes. And what you're going to be doing is you're going to be trying to get five of your token in a row. So I was just thinking, it's like a modern Connect Four, but
it's a Connect
not
really. Five.
Really. It's Connect Five. Yeah. And the way that you're going to be doing this is leapfrogging. And it's a really interesting but easy to understand concept that becomes extremely complex in its strategy, because what you're trying to do is you're moving a ring. So you have a ring, and what you're going to be doing is dropping one of the tokens in of your color and then lifting the ring out from the outside and jumping it or moving it as far along as you like, as long as it doesn't cross over with another ring, onto a blank space in any kind of direction that the lines go in.
Yeah.
And what happens is if you leapfrog other tokens, and it doesn't matter if they're your tokens or your opponent's tokens, they are going to flip, which means the game state changes continuously.
Yeah.
So Maggie might have four white tokens lined up, and then I jump over those four tokens with my black ring, and what that does is turn them all up, and now they're four black tokens.
Yeah.
And so that is just constantly the tug of war that's going on. The other interesting thing about this game is when you do connect five, you pick up all of the tokens and take them off the board, but you also have to remove one of your rings because the ring is the token, is the indicator that you've won one of the lines, and the person who wins the game is going to be the one who gets to connect five three times.
Mm-hmm.
But in order to indicate that, you have to take one of your rings off the board, which makes subsequent rounds harder for you to win, or ongoing.
It's a bit of a handicap,
because now you've got one less piece to play
with. Micro catch-up mechanic, so to speak.
Exactly, yeah. So it is a wonderful, wonderful game. My sister and I have been playing a lot of this over Christmas. She really enjoyed it, and she wanted to play until she beat me. She did beat me. She's very good at games. But, you know, I had her for quite a few, and it was frustrating her. She's like, again. Mm. And it is one of those games where you play it, and I think even you enjoy this one.
I enjoy this more than Devon, actually. Yeah. And again, it's like, obviously, it's very, very abstract. And then as I was playing, I was like, if this had any kind of pasted on theme on it, I would dig it.
More.
Yeah, I would dig it more. Because it is super clever. Like, it's so simple, but for an abstract game, that is quite a satisfying combo of elements at play.
Yeah, so in my collection and all of the GIF games I've tried, probably this and Devon are my two favorites. I get Devon out a lot more just because I don't know, I just know it a bit better, and I find it really funny when everything gets removed suddenly.
Yeah.
So the better game mechanically is probably this one.
Absolutely, yeah. I really like this mechanically.
Yeah, I know you do. But I like probably the meanness more of Devon. So, you know, and that is my preference. Devon is a bit more aggressive. That's why I like it.
Yeah.
But that is also a great game. That is Yinsh. I'm just going to start piles everywhere of games.
Well, this is the last game.
The final game, and this is a long video.
Yeah.
The final game is not really a board game, but kind of adjacent. It is
an escape room.
Yeah, an escape room in a box, the Unlock series. And this one in particular is the Heroic Adventures that has the three, one that's like this 8-bit game, one that's like a Sherlock Holmes kind of investigation, and then the Alice in Wonderland themed escape room at the end. We had not tried any Unlock game.
Really?
Until this one.
I thought we had, but no, I think you're right. Yeah, no. We've done exit games, but not unlocked.
Yeah, so we've played a lot of the exit series. We've played a lot of like this one, another one called Escape Rooms, like a lot of different boxes, but we just never got around to playing an unlock one. It's true. I always hear people talk about them. And so I bought this for the family and we played through it. And it is fascinating. It's quite different to the exit series.
Yeah, it is.
Exit series relies a bit more on the cards, whereas this one is app driven. So there is a central app which allows you to type in codes. There are, as you go through the deck, there are different machines that you discover, and then you type in the number of the machine, which brings up like a completely different little mini game. And it means that the experience for me was much more immersive than the exit series. The exit series I feel like is a puzzle that you are like working through, like cracking codes. It comes with a little book generally, and you're like working your way through a series of puzzles. So it feels like a puzzle book.
It does feel like there's more variety of puzzle styles in exit games because, like they make you do different things and they're kind of more resourceful with different things. Whereas this one is mostly just on the cards and with the app.
That's interesting. I felt that complete opposite of that.
Yeah, well, there you go.
I felt like the exit series starts to become a bit more samey because it's relying more on puzzles that can be written down. Like I felt like there was more drawing, whereas this I felt like there was more deducing, a lot more deducing, so it wasn't just this is the new puzzle, let's forget everything else that we knew from the other puzzles, which is very exit. It's like the exit series goes from one puzzle to the next, and it's very like there's a clear delineation between puzzles, whereas this one was like, oh, this happened, and now I'm building my knowledge about this particular theme. Which, or this thematic storyline.
That's true. Like, thematically, this sort of threaded a story a lot more than the other ones. The other ones, like, you unlock this puzzle, and you unlock this puzzle, and you unlock this puzzle, and then, you've got... And from memory with the other ones, like, they just kind of give you more little bits of narrative. So there's, like, bits of narrative along the way, whereas this... Well, actually, no. I don't know. I don't even know. Because it's like, this is also... I feel like this also did a great job of unfolding the story along the way with more deduction.
I thought this was way more story-led. We are not going to agree on this, but I thought I think Exit to me feels very...
It's been too long since I've played an Exit game,
Exit feels very mechanical to me.
Yes.
And again, the puzzles are just puzzles. And I feel like it's when you go to like an escape room and there's lots of four code locks. That's kind of the feeling I get from an Exit game. Whereas this one with the app and the fact that the machines that you're discovering and the way that two cards go together. So you have to kind of work out which two cards fit together to unlock something next in the story to me has way, way more thematic ties.
Like, about theme.
It's absolutely incredibly thematic.
I agree with that.
So that's why I'm really surprised. Maybe you just... I can't remember that much of that exit.
I don't really have a very good memory. Like, I just kind of go, whoop, blanket. But see, because all I remember from exit games is, like, a lot of, you know, like, you get a piece of paper and then you kind of turn it around and you do this or you do this kind of, like, the sort of mechanical puzzle more than the story. But this one, I also love that it's got the music. When you've got the app going, it's got the music that helps put you right in that spot. In that world.
Way more. And then when you type in something incorrectly, it's like, and it adds a minute, it takes a minute off your time, and you've only got an hour. So the stress is much more palpable in this one
as well. This also felt tougher. Like, these felt harder to get through, to beat. Yeah,
I agree.
Yeah.
So I think actually I have always been quite a promoter of the Exit series, and I still really enjoy those.
Yeah.
But now I'm really keen to try some more of this unlock series. So if you have any recommendations for where we should go after this one, please drop them in the comments, because I definitely want to pick up some more of those. I really enjoy the time pressure and trying to solve everything. Super exciting. This has been a long video, so we had lots to catch up on, because it has been a little while since we posted a video. I'll just briefly talk about this year. We are of course continuing our series Back Chat and Small Talk, and we are looking to, you know, make changes if necessary to the format. We know that there's a lot of people that either love Small Talk or Back Chat. Some people watch both, but there's people that love each of those more, so we probably won't change those too much. But we had some great comments in one of our last videos, wrapping up, I think it was the Backtrack, where we talked about all the games we backed, of people mentioning things they'd like to see from us in 2022. We're going to try and make some of those happen this year.
I think a year of trying a few things and see what
We know these two series are working for us, but there's lots more to do that other, you know, that we haven't explored. Like, I don't know, maybe we might do some streaming at some point, but that is scary, terrifying
commitment. What I'm most looking forward to from a life organization point is having at least one big cull.
Oh yes, we definitely will be doing some
January
culling.
Cull and see what happens.
Yeah.
Make some space, clear up our life, and then just
and get
distill
games onto a shelf as
Get games onto a shelf and distill the library to just like the must-haves for us.
Yes. Yeah. So you can probably expect some of that in the new year. Once we put up some calyxes and then realize we have far too many. Actually, we were looking at they have like on the IKEA website, you can plan out the calyx space and how many of those grids you can fit. And when we're working out how many we can fit in the space we have, and then how many fit in each box, we're like, what do we do with the other half of the collection?
We still need a whole other room's worth of space.
Anyway, so time to get rid of some games. Anyway, we're still talking. We'll stop now. Thank you so much for being here and watching the channel in 2022. Hope you've had a wonderful break. Look forward to talking about many games this year. But otherwise, bye for now.
Yeah, bye.